The 28th Gate, Volume 3, written by Christopher C. Dimond, narrated by Todd Eflin. Season 2. Episode 1. It's kinda hard to start a story with a gun when I didn't have a single functioning weapon on me. All I had was the mangled shape of my warlock, which, and Wall, had allowed me to continue carrying. I think he must have known its constant weight gave me comfort.
"Are you sure about this?"
Enwall asked, his steadfast face wearing the lines of concern he'd carried since I'd first told him about life beyond the Black Gates. I nodded. "I have to go back. I have to find Katherine." I threw a glance at the others who had gathered to see me off, though there weren't many. There didn't need to be. Those who were present would share the memories of the experience. Within a few krons, anyone who wished to know would. And, as Enwall had told me, there were a lot of people who would want to know. Enwall shook his head.
"I am sorry, my friend. It seems a terrible burden they have forced upon you. I do not see the justice in it."
I didn't say anything about the burden that had been forced upon him when the Maunhouser ship came through the quarantine gate after me. He held out a small package for me.
"I regret we are unable to repair your warlock."
His thick, proper accent always made the weapon sound even more exotic. When I opened the gift, I found the blued blade I'd carried when I first came through his gate.
"I had it sharpened for you," he added, "and had a suitable sheath crafted."
I wasn't sure how to thank him. In so many ways, he had been my shepherd since I had arrived in what I'd come to call civilization. He was the first to hear my story, the first to recognize its importance. He'd been a constant advocate and supporter. And when the collective had refused to allow me to return through the gate, and Walls had been one of the first voices raised in protest. He smiled at me. Maybe he already knew what I was thinking, and often felt like he did.
"Good luck, my friend. I do fear you will need it, but I also hope we will see each other again."
He gestured to the others gathered to see me off.
"We will continue what you started."
I nodded and gave him a wan smile. "I know, and thank you." Then, with the last nod of farewell to the others, I climbed into the cockpit of the small, angular shuttle Enwall had given me and prepared to leave civilization. It was only a few moments after my little shuttle appeared on the far side of the Selma IV gate that I realized my mistake. I was already dreading the long haul to reach Selma III, where I could ask Quatra for help. I didn't have a Q-com, and the general comms on the little shuttle were too advanced to pick up basic chatter, so I figured I might as well start the long run from the closest gate. But if I'd thought about it more carefully, I'd have asked Enwall to send me back through the Selma II gate. Let's just say I've had a few encounters with Fayette Corp, the corp that controls Selma IV, and they have a long history of aggressiveness. As such, I didn't receive any warning messages. It only dawned upon me the situation I was in when a Fayette interceptor destroyer began moving to block my course. And a moment's inspection revealed two more Fayette ships beyond, also moving to intercept. Needless to say, I wasn't in the mood for delays, to say nothing of corporate detainment. So I cranked up the engines on my little shuttle and launched forward. And I will say, that little thing is fast. I mean, really, it's the single fastest ship I've ever seen, aside from Commander Umstard's research ship, which we last saw cruising away faster than light. As my shuttle rushed past the first Fayette ship, the others behind it opened fire, angry blue tracers marking the EM rounds they had chosen. But that didn't matter. I'll give your people credit. They were smart enough to harden the shuttle against electromagnetic interference and subsequently EM rounds. Well, that just gave me one more reason to dislike Fayette. But without any weapons, I was helpless to retaliate. Instead, I rolled my course to put a little more distance between me and the firing ships, then focused on pushing as much speed as I could. A few more flashes came close, but within subgrons, I was well out of the Fayette ship's offensive ranges. After that, I took a deep breath and settled in for the long haul to Selma 3, still impressed by just how fast the little shuttle could move. By the time I arrived, I figured I must have covered the distance in a quarter of the time it would have taken the Esta, which is a rather swift ship in its own right. When I hit orbit around Selma 3, I didn't feel like taking the time with the general port, particularly considering the challenge of my advanced communications equipment. Instead, I blitzed right past the main port of the Citizens Unincorporated Municipal Area and forced a landing in Quatra's small private port. This, of course, without any communications, caused something of a commotion with Quatra's security team, and I was grumpy enough I didn't help matters. But after one of them was willing to relay to Quatra who it was that had landed at her private port, she quickly set things right. After that, a couple of her people escorted me into her building, and I was surprised when we entered the elevator and went down rather than up. I was so accustomed to the showrooms at the top of her grand tower, I didn't even realize she had below-ground infrastructure as well. The small, utilitarian room they left me in didn't appear terribly inviting, and was a sharp contrast to the airy, grand exhibit hall she preferred to host in at the tower's top. Instead, this was a room easily secured from prying interests. I approved. Quatra and another man entered a few subgrons later, but before I could say anything, Quatra held up a hand.
"One moment, Hunter dear."
She moved to a small electronics console on the wall where she worked for a moment.
"There,"
she said, turning back to stare at me with a critical eye.
"Now we can talk."
I shot a suspicious glance at the man still standing in the doorway. He was tall and thin, but carried himself like someone with a lot of combat training.
"Bartold Green," Quatra introduced, "my new head of security. He doesn't have ties to Fayette Corp."
There was more than a hint of bitter sarcasm in her voice, which was fair considering her previous head of security had been selling her shipping routes to Fayette. But I had other things to focus on. "Do you know where Katherine is?" I asked. Quatra's eyes narrowed a little, as though working through how to interpret the question. Then she gave me a slow nod.
"From what I've been able to gather, Maunhouser has her. I've been trying to collect some information on where, but Maunhouser's security has been rather, well, they had an incident with their prized research installation some while back, so they've been revamping all their security measures. It's made things difficult for me."
Quatra paused, then gave me that penetrating look again.
"But where have you been? It's been sub-rev since I've tried to talk you out of that foolhardy assault on Maunhauser's secret gate."
I shot another glance at Green, who was still standing impassively by the doorway.
"It's fine," Quantra said. "He already knows."
I nodded, then took a deep breath, returning to Quantra's question about where I'd been. It was, of course, a question I'd been expecting. I'd even spent most of my time in transit, working through the best way to explain it all. And I figured, if anyone would believe what I had been through, Quatra would. Even so, I wasn't quite sure how to begin. "Catherine's plan worked," I started. "I managed to hold off Maunhauser's forces long enough for her to get their secret gate, the 28th gate, operational. But then she told me she couldn't go with me. She'd planned from the beginning to stay behind while sending me through. By that point, it was too late to call it off. I was already drifting into the gate. Even so, I figured I would reach oversight, and they'd shut down Maunhauser before they dared to do anything to Katherine. But the problem started when I didn't arrive where we thought I would." Quatra nodded.
"I had Kershaw waiting for you near the Alopa gate. When he never spotted you, I worried something had gone wrong."
She gave me that look again.
"Do you think Katherine messed up?"
I shook my head. "No, it wasn't her fault. She didn't know the gates.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.